Good morning. I'm Mike Griffin, and you are at Forum 360, where we're going to focus on what aerospace is going to be like in the future, and the workforce needs to accommodate that. Is Pam Bertelsen here? Well, when she shows up, she can tell me the code to activate the iPad so that I can read the questions. In the meantime, we've got a distinguished panel here to talk this morning. We have Doug Ebersole, who's executive director of Air Force Research Lab. Kevin Parsons is director of innovation and transformation at Northrop Grumman Aerospace. Robbie Samantaroy, a longtime colleague of mine in government circles. He's now VP for Technology, Strategy, and Innovation at Lockheed Martin. Ken Sanger, former AIAA colleague, but vice president and general manager for 787 development at Boeing. And Lisa Teague, who heads research and technology at Rolls-Royce in Indianapolis. I'm going to use up just a few minutes for my introductory remarks, and then each of the panel members will take about 10 minutes, which will use up our first hour. We're not going to indulge in a lot of going over of bios and all that. You can read that online. And then we're going to have an hour for questions and answers and interaction with the audience, and hopefully between and among the panel members. I think and hope it'll be a stimulating discussion this morning. So for my introductory comments, I want to call our attention to the fact that we're being asked to look at aerospace 20, 30, 40, 50 years out. And when I look at that challenge, I think back 46 years ago to when I began in this profession in the spring of 1971. And one of the sobering things that I think we all have to face as we look at the future of aerospace is, if you look back at it, leaving aside the growth of the various branches of information technologies, leaving aside Moore's Law, we could do more in 1971 in aerospace than we can do today. Aerospace is the only field of which I am aware where you can go to museums and see things, see stuff you wish you still had. On the aero side, I can look at the SR-71 and say, you know, that was pretty impressive and we can't do it today. From the back of my house, I can see a model of the Saturn V standing up in Huntsville and, you know, we can't do that today, and so on. That's a sobering point. So let's make the assumption that as we go forward in the next 30, 40, 50 years, that we're going to reverse that trend, that we'll be able to do a lot more 50 years from now in 2067 than we can do here in 2017. Let's assume things are going to turn around again. And then let's take a look at another, in some ways for us aero guys, at another sobering fact, which is that for much of the first century of aerospace, for most of it, it was about the platform, starting with the Wright Flyer and working on up, and then as we branched out into space, first with military needs, ICBMs, things like that, then satellites and commercial communication satellites and GPS and many, many, many things that we've done since then. In many ways, it was about developing platforms for air and space. And so, you know, the utilization of the platforms was important, but the real technical challenge was developing the platforms themselves. As we look forward for the next 30, 40, 50 years, my guess is that we've seen already the transition from platform centricity to utilization. It's all about what goes on the platforms now. The F-35 is a very advanced weapon system, not because it flies better than other airplanes, but because of what it carries. and so on. I won't belabor the point. So we're going to need a workforce, in my view, which will differ quite substantially. The applications will be aerospace applications, and there'll be aerospace platforms, but who knows? And maybe that's what we'll talk about today, the wide range of engineers that we'll need to fit out those platforms with what each individual application needs. So let me stop there. I'm looking forward to the discussion about what aerospace will look like in the next several decades and who will be the people who succeed those of us who have gray hair or no hair, and we're trying to see which is going to win out the battle, right? So with that, let me introduce Doug Ebersole. We're just going to go in alphabetical order. I'm told it makes it easier for the AV guys, and I have no reason to prefer another order. So Doug, you're up. You're 10 minutes.
Well, great. So happy to be here. And this is one of the times when it's good to be, towards the A, not towards Z, because at least by the time they get to you, everything's already going to be said. I'm going to frame my 10 minutes in the context of being really the only government guy here. I've had the privilege of working in the research area of the Air Force for the last 3 years, but predominantly I spent most of my career in the acquisition world. And I'm going to take my 10 minutes and do sort of an environmental scan of where I see the challenges of the United States Air Force's, Department of Defense going forward is. And then I'm going to kind of look through those challenges through the lenses of people, process, and product. And I'm going to do that in the reverse order, just to kind of give you some thoughts or some talking points. Starting about sort of the environmental scan, though, you know, if you look at the world today, the tech advantage that the Department of Defense had during Desert Storm 1, with the advent of stealth and precision strike weapons, that technical advantage has eroded significantly. And I think as we look into the future, into the time frame as you describe, I don't think you can assume that advantage is always going to be there. I use the very, near peer is the phrase you use. I start using the very near peer. I still think the ingenuity of the U.S. Industrial base is going to give us some advantage, but it's not going to be what it was. So my boss, General Palakowski, even talks about if you say there's equivalence in technology base in the future, then it's going to be the first that evolves that technology or modifies it simply to what they see that day is going to win the fight. The other thing about technology going forward, as we've seen, is the technology cycle times have gone down. Where technology would live for tens of years, in some areas of the AF World portfolio right now, technology cycle times are measured in months, specifically in cyber. So when we start to unpack some of the processes that are required to be, you'll see some issues and challenges there. I think the other thing going forward is, when we're seeing it today, is the panel here sort of is what I would call sort of traditional aerospace industrial America. And I think you're going to see more and more use in DoD of non-traditional sources. Clearly, we're reliant on companies like SpaceX, but Amazon, Google, what does it mean when a commercial entity puts 4,000 satellites in space, a non-DoD commercial entity? How do we in the department leverage that? That's part of the scan, I think, of the future environment. And I'll kind of close with sort of just a vignette of the challenges. If you look at the anti-access aerial deny environment today, it's ever increasing and it's getting extremely difficult. You couple that with the concerns of airbase resiliency, specifically in the Pacific area of operations where there's not a whole lot of landmass out there, and you have the tyranny of distance. Those two combinations of A2AD environment with now, sort of the challenges of airbase resiliency really puts one of the cores of how the Air Force does business, which is power projection from the rear, at risk. So sort of a bleak story, but there's huge challenges out there, and that's that message. So when you look at that, then let's talk a little bit about you know, products and processes and then eventually the people here. So quickly, from a product perspective, we know well how to do exquisite and expendable. You know, exquisite maybe embodified by, you know, an F-35. I mean, incredible. I've worked that program. You know, what that platform can bring to the fight is incredible. Expendable weapons, we've been doing that for years. We believe in AFRL, and we're placing a fairly big bet in an area somewhere between there called attritable, that says it's probably not a human, you know, there's not anybody on board that platform, but it's something I want to put out. I want to go do a mission with it, but I'd like it to return. It's all about cost. So how do I somehow get somewhere in between there where I can get an attritable asset that if I can get 100 flights out of, that's what I want. And then maybe on that 100th flight, when it's running out of life, it's a one-way trip. You know, I make it expendable. So that's an area of, I think, the product evolving over time. Human-machine teaming, that's something that we're making huge bets in. Autonomy, you know, making decisions at the speed of computers, that is a future. And again, that's where I think we can learn from non-traditional sources. We need to get into a domain where we've talked about this for years. I've been in this business for 30 years, and it's changed its name over time, but the ability to easily upgrade, getting back to this, how do I have a product that can quickly modify, that's going to be part of the future. Moving on to some processes. So let's talk about some processes that will enable this. We're already beginning to realize that, you know, taking a year to get on contract is not going to be a sustainable future. We've gotten some examples out of our cyber area where we are starting to pursue other means, other transactions authority. We've gone from RFP to contract award in less than 30 days. That's the future that we need. We also need to do different methods of acquiring value streams from industry, crowdsourcing, challenges. Those are things that are beginning to employ in the S&T environment. One of the things I want to talk a little bit about from a process perspective, we believe all the outcomes that we're going to want to generate in the future are going to come from multi-domains. It's going to be a combination of air, space, and cyber that is going to drive a desired outcome on the battlefield. So from a process perspective, for those that are industry or DOD, what does a defense acquisition board look like for a multi-domain product set? You know, this came to me when I'm looking at a PEO. I was sitting in a PEO CEO conference, and I got PEO fighters, PEO bombers, PEO space. Our money comes down in stovepipes. We manage it through stovepipes. But if I have an outcome that I want to generate that's a combination of a space program combined with an air program, with a cyber program, and unless all three of those come in together, I derive zero value, that would be a challenging thing to do for today in the acquisition world that we have. So I challenge the audience to noodle on that a little bit. The other thing I will talk about from a process perspective, is data rights. Big debate, but if we are going to really pursue these multi-domain solutions, then, and I'm not sure I really like this answer, but by and large, the government is going to be the integrator. And if we're going to be the integrator, then we got to two things. Own the data, and then to migrate into the discussion about people, we really need to step up our game from a people perspective, being responsible for that systems integration of multi-domain solutions. So let's talk about people in my last 2 minutes. You know, the one thing I think is going to be, the acquisition, the search for really good people is going to be constrained in the future, and it's going to be contested. And from a government perspective, so how do we compete in that kind of environment? And, the strategies that we employ are, we find that we can recruit and retain our best people when we get them early. You know, when we get them while they're still in college, through internships, with cooperative programs. We have some authorities within the government where just in my time as the executive director, you know, we can retire their student loans as an incentive to come to the government. But once we get them, we've established a human capital strategy in Air Force Research Lab, grounded in the work of Daniel Pink, if you're familiar with, which is, you know, autonomy, mastery, and purpose. And the reality of it is, the only way we hook civilians and the civilian workforce for long term is you got to get them hooked into the purpose. We're all great Americans. We're all, you know, working for the same end goal, which is the defense of the nation. But we find that if we can get them hooked on the purpose, then we have the best chance of retaining them. All that said, and maybe we'll talk about millennials a little bit today. They're a very demanding part of the workforce, and one of the things that we are beginning to employ to retain that workforce is flexibility. Flexibility in the day, flexibility in the week, flexibility in the year. We've created a new program called the Developmental Opportunities Program, which essentially allows our researchers to go do sabbaticals. But now we've expanded that to an Entrepreneur Opportunities Program, where if they have a bent towards starting their own company, leveraging the technology that they're developing in-house, we'll send them away for a year. They can go build their business plan. They can go do market validation. And then if they decide to start that company, we'll hire them back in 5 years if it doesn't work out. We've got two active in it right now. We've graduated a couple of folks already out of that program that are doing well. I think those are the things that we need to do to recruit and retain the workforce of the future. My time is up. Kevin,
thanks, Doug. Great. Kevin?
Thank you. I'm going to stand just because
I
don't like sitting. No, I don't like all those either. So.
Okay. All right.
First question, how many of you have teenagers at home? Anybody? So when he started off by saying how you dab, did you think, you know, yeah, that's what I thought too. So how many of you have seen the movie Hidden Figures? It just came out in theaters. So highly, highly recommend, especially for this audience, that you see that movie. Very inspiring stories of three women who persevered and made an incredible difference in our space program. I took my family there this last weekend, and one quote came to mind as I was preparing for the talk today. And that was a quote by Kevin Costner, where Kevin himself said, "In my head, we're already there." He was being asked about the space program and the possibility of men on the moon. Now, at that point in time, they were just trying to get a man in orbit to orbit the Earth, but he was already thinking in the future. So, as we think about the future and the future of the aerospace industry, some of you may feel like you're already there in your head. You already feel like you have a pretty clear picture of what it looks like. I want to share a couple of things that I feel are part of our future, and I think one of them is a lot harder to get to than the other. Let's see if you agree with the one that I think is the one. First of all, and Doug, you touched on this, autonomous systems will be ubiquitous, not only in the aerospace industry, but I would say throughout. And I would also caveat that by saying thinking or cognitive autonomous systems will be ubiquitous. There are a lot of industries right now that are thinking about autonomous systems, that are working on them. We all know about the driverless cars by Google. We all know that there is a lot of research, as a matter of fact, perhaps more research than dollars that are even being done in the aerospace industry around autonomy. So that, I think, is a clear part of our future. That would be hard to argue with. The second one is, I think the organizations of the future in aerospace will look very different than the organizations today. And the reason for that is survival. I think there are three attributes of organizations of the future that are key. One is silos are not tolerated anymore. There's a need, a fundamental need, for getting out of our silos in order for us to survive and to advance and to innovate. We have to collaborate outside our traditional silos. The second point is bureaucracy, hierarchy, process inefficiency, cost, schedule. Those things are also not tolerated. And the organization of the future, the organization that succeeds into the future, will figure out how to make sure that those things are rooted out. And the third area that I think is going to be an attribute of the organization of the future is that the people, the employees that work for that organization, are empowered to bring their whole selves to work. We throw that term around a lot, but how often are we in a job where we are viewed only as having those skills and capabilities associated with that job, that title, that one thing? And yet we can contribute in so many more ways to the organization we're part of. That takes really understanding our people, knowing them holistically, not just in the one little attribute or skill that we've hired them to do at that moment. And the organization of the future, the aerospace company or government organization, I think will figure out what that looks like and how to make sure we can leverage all of what our people are and can do and are capable of and go from there. So I want to go back. I brought up two points. Organizations are way different, and autonomy is an aspect of our future. Which of those two things do you think is harder? If you think of the autonomy piece is harder, raise your hand. Lights are pretty bright, but I don't see a single hand up. I agree. Organizational change is one of the hardest things we have. And yet we frequently don't even hire practitioners of organizational change to help us. It's our most powerful lever. Doug, I'm glad you brought up Dan Pink because his book Drive, and there's a YouTube video, a great whiteboard video that's powerful that describes this. Autonomy, mastery, and purpose. Those things are so critical and so important, and how we are able to move our organizations in the right direction are huge lever arms for performance, for innovation, for our future. So I want to go back and I want to touch on those points again with the second half of my time. First of all, autonomy. I mentioned that autonomy will be all over the place. Thinking systems, cognitive autonomy. We have a whole research area around cognitive autonomy. You might be thinking Terminator. That's a possibility too, right? We have to be aware of that. How do you put morals, how do you put kind of the human compass inside machines if they're going to make decisions for themselves? That's a real huge challenge, but an exciting one. I actually think that in the future, not only will it'd be all over the place. Think about robotic construction. Think about robotic drilling and mining. Not only driving car or driverless cars, but flying cars as well. But I think the algorithms, the sensor arrays, the fundamental technologies to enable it will probably also be shared across industries, will probably be common across industries. Should we be developing it ourselves? Probably not. Because there's a tremendous amount of research that we can take advantage of across industries, but we have to get out of our silos and talk across industries as well. So to the second point about organizational change, first of all, silos. There's a lot of thought leadership right now that talks about how performance and innovation are enabled most and best when we get out of our silos, when we contribute more broadly and talk to people kind of across the aisle. You know, we talk about defense, commercial, hobbyists, retail. You know, there's international, there's primes, there's subs, there's air, there's space. How often do we put our people and our organizations in these very tightly controlled areas and say, all right, there's your operating area. We need to get out and we need to talk. Imagine this. What if AIAA and the Consumer Electronics Show, CES, got together and did a joint conference? Wow, that'd be cool. You think we'd learn something new rather than talking amongst ourselves every time we get together? How can we get inspired by a different group of people? What if the survivability and stealth folks decided to meet with professional magicians? Sleight of hand, stealth. You think they know a couple things about that? You think there might be some nuggets in there that might inspire us to think differently about that? What if on the cyber side, we got together with the banking industry? Holy cow, their cyber problems are huge. I was just in New York City in June with Barclays and MasterCard Labs, and they talked about how that is their number one thing is cyber. They're investing tremendously. I'm sure they have more money than we do to invest in cyber. Why aren't we getting together with them all the time? And the list can go on. I challenge each of you to inspire yourselves by going to spaces and places that are non-traditional. I went to CES a few years ago. Oh my goodness, it was awesome. And I kept thinking, I wonder if that could apply to what we're doing here. I wonder if that automation for cars, I wonder if that small device could be put in a satellite or on an aircraft platform. I challenge each of us to do that. Second point was bureaucracy, hierarchies, process improvement, get rid of them, or not process improvement, but bureaucratic processes and inefficiency, get rid of them. I have a friend who's executive in the movie industry, and through my interactions with him, we talk a lot about storytelling, and in movies, the importance of the story, and those master storytellers, and what do they do when they're developing a storyline? One of the things that surprised me the most is in the editing room, they are brutal, absolutely brutal. Every single scene, line, word that does not directly contribute to the story, to developing the plot, to developing a character, something that advances the storyline, it has to go. No matter how cute, how funny, how inspiring that scene is, if it doesn't align with moving the movie forward, the best storytellers get rid of it. How are we getting rid of all those things we do on a day-to-day basis, actively rooting them out that don't contribute to the mission, to our ultimate mission? I wonder if we looked at our calendars and said, what percentage of time do we spend on those things that aren't advancing the mission? I wonder how much of the contracting and the financial accounting and you name it, the time in our reviews, our PDRs and CDRs, don't actually advance the mission. We need to be aggressively rooting those things out. And it's a partnership. I'm not talking to just industry or government, commercial. All of us need to get together and say, we need to do something about this. It's not in the best interest of us or our nation. Okay. And then the final point was around employees contributing in every way they possibly can. We need to know who our employees are. So I would encourage you to get to know your people, not only professionally, but personally, and ask questions of who they are. We've been asking questions. I learned that Northrop Grumman has an internationally certified U.S. figure skating judge. That's an engineer by day and a figure skating judge by night. Who knew? How can we leverage that diversity of thought in what we do? So I'll close with a quote back to Hidden Figures, a quote also by Kevin Costner, who said that I'm going to have to read it. We all get to the peak together, or we don't get to the peak at all. And so we need to get out of our silos and work together, and I think that's the future of the aerospace industry and the workforce. Thank you.
Excellent. Very good. All right.
Robbie, your turn.
All right. Thank you, Mike, for moderating this panel, and thank you for the opportunity to join this esteemed panel. As we talked about in the opening panel yesterday, this conference is really focusing on the four perspectives or dimensions of disruption in the aerospace sector. There's the technology front, there's the business model front, there's the policy front, and there's the workforce front. I'm going to talk a little bit about the workforce elements here, and also I'd like to make a shout out to you on Friday. So this is the last day of the conference. I still hope that there are plenty of people that remain. There is going to be a plenary session in the morning that will be moderated by Dr. Daryl Pines, who's the Dean of Engineering at the University of Maryland, also talking about workforce issues a bit from the supply side and since we are really talking about the future workforce, there will actually be future workforce panelists, because I'm sorry to say, but I don't think any of the future workforce panelists are here. We're sort of giving us our, nice, you know, collective experience, but at the end, we have got to be, from a participatory diversity perspective, have people that are going to be... Exactly, that's right. So what I like to sort of start off to frame is that essentially when you look across the workforce issue, there are multiple layers. There's a global level, there's a national level, there's a sectoral level, and then in our region, quite frankly, there are regional or local issues. Because at the end of the day, as they say, politics or real estate is all about locality. Sometimes workforce is also about locality. But at the global level, the AIAA is an international organization. We have so many countries that are represented, but again, we are all here representing the US. And from an international global perspective, there is a competition for the best of talent. And where is it going? You know, years ago, the US drew the best and the brightest from across the world, and most of them stayed in the US. Today, we still educate the best and the brightest. You look across our graduate school populations, and you have more than 50%, 60% in electrical engineering, computer science, that are non-US citizens. Today, do they stay, or do they go back? We're educating them, and they're now competition in this global environment. There's been a lot of talk, a lot of rhetoric, a lot of policy discussions about how do we retain those really bright individuals. You know, there's been discussions about when you cross your stage and getting your PhD, can you staple a green card? Those are things we have to think about. At the national level and at the sectoral level, we're in competition across all these other sectors. We representing the aerospace sector, the traditional aerospace sector. We're in competition with other sectors. You know, when we joked yesterday about Silicon Valley, or really Software Valley, and the fact that Buzz Aldrin had said years ago, I asked for Mars and you gave me Facebook. We're actually in competition with the whole generation that is now in dealing with coding. But at the end of the day though, when you look at the Achilles heels of many aerospace programs, it's software. So when we look at competition for others and from a technology perspective, we have a long ways to go still in software. Everybody's enamored with apps and software. But if you look across over history, how hardware has exponentially, driven by Moore's Law, you know, driven from a performance perspective, have driven these immense improvements, still today, what's the rule of thumb? How many lines of error-free code can a good programmer put out per day? That metric hasn't changed for decades. So there's an interesting, from a technology perspective, we're going to have to work with a new burgeoning workforce that's used to app development, a lot of coding, but still fundamentally change the development paradigms of software. The other issue is that if you remember a number of years ago, I think it was the National Science Foundation was, and even DARPA was pushing the nexus of info, bio, nano. And many of these convergences we're seeing today. But at the end of the day, I think on the bio side, the broad aerospace sector is going to have to embrace things that are really changing at a breakneck speed. And I'm talking about synthetic biology, systems biology, bio-inspired engineering. There's a whole workforce out there that I think we're going to have to bring into the aerospace sector and really change how we do material science, how we do sensing, how we do fundamental systems engineering. Then lastly, I just mentioned a little bit at the regional, the local level. I mean, there's all the dynamics of, you know, the enamorment of Silicon Valley. There's all these other ecosystems across the country. And each of us from a government and from an industry perspective, we recruit from local areas. And that drives the dynamics of the universities, the community colleges for technicians, et cetera. It's an interesting dynamic that we have to kind of think about from a demographic perspective. The other important thing that I think we have to talk about is that we are across the aerospace sector, at least in the national security arena, we really have an ecosystem which is a triad of government, industry, and academia. And there have been a number of individuals that have been really pushing the concept of do not stay within your stovepipe. that you need to flow across to all of these sectors, and that your experiences, your expertise is going to enrichen. You'll learn from each of these three areas, and that you can actually contribute across the broader ecosystem. So I really laud Doug and the things you're doing at AFRL, the Development Opportunity Program, the Entrepreneurial Opportunity Program. I sometimes tell some folks in Lockheed Martin, the government is a little bit being more innovative on some of these workforce issues than industry. And I see that you have researchers in academia that are now going to, for instance, the Army Research Lab has an open innovation campus. They're doing sabbaticals there. I'd like to see researchers at AFRL come and do sabbaticals within industry. We send our lab folks to government labs. So this flow is going to be very important. And we've become very risk adverse. There's all these, you know, yes, it's true. We cannot, basically deny there's conflict of interest issues, et cetera. But those are policy issues that we can manage risk. We cannot avoid, you know, or actually shut down these levels of interaction just because we're too scared of a conflict of interest. So I think that's something that's going to be very important. And I personally have to be very thankful for all the experiences I've had in my past is to be able to flow across these elements of our ecosystem. But I think it's very important that we push the flow across the enterprise. The other key thing is that, and this has been mentioned a little bit, that the expectations and motivations of the future workforce have changed. I mean, how many of us and in this audience were motivated by, you know, the space race, and there's Sputnik, and then there's the Apollo, you know, program, or just, you know, growing up in the 80s and in the 90s, you just loved aerospace. Now we're competing across so many other communities. And so what motivates, you know, this young workforce to come work within the aerospace sector? I think it's about the mission, it's about hard problems. And the way that you go, within Lockheed Martin, we say, you know, do you want to work on an app that's going to get you a better, you know, fill in the blank from a social media perspective? Or do you want to do something that's going to enable the exploration of the farthest reaches of space, right? Or you contribute to the next generation of a national security system? So I think it's really important that we sell that mission, that sense of purpose, that is going to be really important to energize the workforce. But at the same time, we're going to have to live with the fact that the future workforce is not going to stay at a company forever, right? They're going to want to move around. And this gets back to my first point about the flow. It gets back to my point about in large companies, we want them to basically go out and have experiences across the other sectors, go off and try to do, you know, start your company. If you fail, come back to the mothership. If you are successful, we'll buy you. We'll cash into your IP. So these are things that we have to think about. But the challenge is that, you know, in aerospace, there's as much science as there is art. And one of the key things that we have to all, you know, collectively manage is knowledge transfer, knowledge management. Because there are things, there's like a material process or something that happened with this adhesive that there's like two people in the company that understood what happened. And when they retire, what happens next? And that leads to my final point, which is on the educational side. There's, you know, there have been so many interesting issues across universities, how to cram in so much at the undergraduate level. You know, are students prepared for industry? We have to make sure that they have, you know, foundational, science and technology. They have to have systems engineering. You know, I today think it's great that the whole issue of design, build, test, you actually get your hands onto hardware, something that is very important. That's going to be really, really important for the future workforce, cramming all of this knowledge into, you say, less than 5 years. But I think the important thing is that when these young workforce comes into industry, you know, they have to work with those that have all of this knowledge, and we have to work on better mechanisms on how we do this knowledge transfer. And so I think that's going to be a really important issue moving forward. That lastly I want to mention is the cultural aspect. And that really is something that you mentioned, Kevin, is much more difficult from an organizational perspective. But I think that is something that we ultimately have to address and agree upon. So I think those are a couple of sort of high-level things, and I'm looking forward to the conversation and the questions from the audience. Thank you.
We've got so many interesting topics to talk about. We'll never have all the time we need, but thanks. Those are thought-provoking comments, Robbie. Ken, over to you.
Yeah, good morning.
Hey, so Doug, you're right when you're on this end of the panel. So what I'll try to do is share some thoughts that complement and share some ideas as well. But a lot of good information thus far. Let's see, I want to thank Dr. Tom Shee for inviting us to do this. There's a strong Purdue connection here and an AIAA connection. So I appreciate that, Tom. Let's see, so I'm the Boeing guy, and we're taught at Boeing that you have to show up with either a couple charts or a video. No video this morning, but I do have a couple charts, and we'll use that. I think what you'll see is it will quickly flush out some of the things that the other panelists have already talked about as well. So can I see the next chart, please?
Green to forward, red to back up.
Okay. My AV people will tell you I'm dangerous with this. But anyway, so first starting off, Kevin had referenced a movie, right? So, you know, trying to play off of that, I'm going to surprise this a little bit. So how many people growing up watched the cartoon The Jetsons? I'd like to see your hand. Oh, this is good. This is good. Okay, so we're all the baby boomers. I didn't look. Did any of my panel members? Okay, good. Mike wouldn't admit to it, but... So for the rest of you, that makes you the millennials. Okay, now why do I bring up the Jetsons, right? You wouldn't expect that in a panel. But think about, what were the Jetsons about? It was a family of the future, wasn't it? Remember that? So George Jetson, how did he get to work? He had his own personal aircraft, right? I didn't see any gas emissions from that thing, did you? So it was clean. It was clean. And then how about robotics and automation? You saw a lot of that, right? In fact, he had a personal robot that took care of the house and so forth. So you saw a lot of that in the cartoon. And they took vacations, other remote places, right? So space travel. So think about that. A cartoon that was developed, I think, first aired in 1962, 55 years ago. 55 years ago. So when I started and Tom invited me to do this, I thought, well, this will be a fun panel because, you know, you're speculating on the future and, you know, really there's no wrong answer. But I was, in thinking back, you know, the creators of that cartoon got a lot, if you look at the chart, got a lot of that right, right? So delving into a few of these things, and again, complementing some of the remarks made before me, we talked about autonomous flight. You know, clearly we're moving in that direction, and I compliment the automotive industry because they're going at a faster rate than we have. If you think about it, we've been in UAVs probably 30 plus years, right? And look how long it's taken us to get, to a platform. Okay, look at how quickly the automobile industry is moving. We're in the hypersonics again. I think you're going to see supersonic flight come back. And of course, all these modes of transportation are going to have to be efficient and cost effective. Let's see, automation, the primes like the Boeings and the Lockheeds and such, we're moving very quickly in automation. I think you'll see that the second tier and the third tier players will do so as well. The key here, I think, in terms of the speed that our industry moves is in terms of our ability to manage the capital investment. Okay, and this is, we talked a little bit about the human to robot interaction. Okay, integration on these big programs, whether it's the 787 or a defense platform, we can't lose sight that integration has to happen, that communication has to happen, whether it's between man and man, man and machine, or machine and machine. To be successful, we're going to need to continue to master that. Space travel, A lot of excitement today relative to getting to Mars. And credit the billionaires who have brought money in and have shown interest in this, because I think it's all good. We need to stimulate this interest back into space. It's, you know, comments Mike made in the introduction. We need to generate that interest, and I think we need to be inclusive in our industry, regardless of who the new players are. Right? This should not be us deciding how to keep people out, but how to leverage those adjacencies and leverage those alliances. So I don't think it's, you know, it's limited to one company, one group of companies. We have to integrate with all the new players. And without getting into detail, I think you'll find that the major companies are doing that. The other comment I would make here is in the center of the chart, you see virtual global marketplace. And I think everybody here knows about virtual reality marketplace. What am I talking about there? Well, it's what we've been talking about here, people, resource, right? The marketplace for people. And I'll talk in a subsequent chart in terms of what that means. And then before I leave this one, just recognition there are important considerations. Because, for example, with all the automation, I read something like in the next 10, 15 years, half of the factory jobs could be done by machines. And so how do we manage that? Do the people work into more knowledge-based jobs? Do they migrate into other professions? Will we see greater unemployment? Well, if you look today, unemployment is fairly low, and yet we've been moving into automation, right? So how is the ecosystem, if you will, adjusted for that? Let's go to the next chart, please. Oh, I can do that. There you go. Just, you know, talking about where we're going in terms of workforce. As a few of us have said, you know, spent a lot of time in the industry, and you see changes in terms of the workforce and the work environment. Much of that has been enabled by technology. So on the 787, you know, the people who work for me have laptops that are just as powerful as the desktops and, in some instances, mainframes that I grew up with. Okay, I think, you know, we've commented in terms of changes in the work environment, and I think Robbie mentioned, you know, the larger companies, we have to create that flexible environment to allow people to work on a particular program or project, and then the flexibility to, you know, go off and work somewhere else in the company that justifies their desire for staying with a large company. I think you will also see people that will be more contractor-like, and that they'll come to work for a company, whether large or small. And as we talked about, they'll take a sabbatical, they'll walk the rainforest, whatever, and then they'll come back into the workforce. And so we have to create an environment that allows for that. The last point I would make here is that the interesting part of this is it really is an opportunity. You know, when we talk about the flexible workforce, we have to leverage the opportunity in that. You know, it's a very global environment. And so, for example, on the 787, you know, we've enabled have the ability to where we may have a team working in either India or Moscow work on a problem. And then as their day ends and, for example, Philadelphia or Charleston comes up in their shift, they pass the problem or the work to that part of the company. And then as Seattle comes up, you know, Seattle takes it over, and then we repeat the cycle. So that's enabled us to be more efficient, and particularly if problems come up, to really go attack problems much more quickly. So anyway, some thoughts. Hopefully this creates some ideas for all of you to ask us some further questions. And I'll turn it back to Mike.
Well, thanks, and appreciate that. And I'm just going to turn it over to Lisa to bat cleanup, and then we'll get into the more interactive section.
Okay. Well, Doug, since I am at the end, I can wrap this up and save us 10 minutes by saying, yeah, what they said. But I'm not going to. I'm going to say some things anyways. We really have come a long way. Aerospace has come a long way. We're now more efficient, cleaner, quieter. You know, safety, of course, continues to be number one. Everything we do has to be very safe. But we've continued to make significant improvements in environmental impact, reliability, all that. If you look at the large civil Rolls-Royce engines, the Trent family of engines, each generation of that continues to make improvements in fuel burn noise and emissions. And the next generation, the Advanced and Ultra Fan, will be 20 or 25% more efficient in fuel burn than the first generation Trent, which was back in the late 90s. But we're not stopping there. NASA, Akari, who sets European environmental targets, you know, we're still striving to continue to go further, and particularly with some of the goals, the fuel burn goals of the future. The engine guys, these guys hopefully will rely on us for a while longer. We can't get there ourselves. You know, systems integration and working with these airframers to get us there is going to be key to the future, because the engine guys can't get us there all on our own. So for Rolls-Royce, some of the areas that we're focusing on for product innovation, we still need to continue to advance the gas turbine engine. Engines are complex. There's still room to be gained in improvement for that. It takes a long time to make improvements in some areas. We still have technical experts. We have a need for technical experts. We have about 150 fellows we count on to be the technical experts in their fields, and including looking out there, looking for disruptive technologies that we should be aware of and bringing in to where we might need it. But increasingly, systems and systems integration is really important. Again, because we can't do all this on our own with propulsion. If you look at key technology areas where we have acknowledged the need to focus on technology development. It's a mix. It's a mix of component technologies, a mix of demonstrators, of system demonstrators to put it all together, and then taking advantage of what high-performance computing and intelligent systems and all that can offer us in the future as well. So we'll need to continue to have the specialist and the generalist. And electrification is one of those areas where there's need for both the specialist and the generalist as we keep on going with that trend. And all that needs a multidisciplinary, entrepreneurial look at how we're going to combine all these systems to make a better product in the future. And here's some pictures of some engine airframe integration. The F-35 was mentioned earlier. Great aircraft. Rolls-Royce has a lift system in the F-35B that provides the vertical thrust so this 40,000-pound aircraft can take off in just an amazingly short period of runway and come back and hover and land vertically. Very integrated, structurally integrated in the aircraft. You got doors that open and close. You got nozzles that move around. You have a control system that with all this complex system, the control system is integrated, and we can't do that without looking at it as a whole system. Now, there on the bottom left, you see some pictures from Northrop Grumman, Lockheed Martin, and Boeing, the studies that we did with each one of them on NASA Environmentally Responsible Aviation Program. And they don't look quite like what you see on commercial flights these days. But it was great to have the chance to do those studies. The picture on the right is the program that we're working on with Aurora Flight Sciences under DARPA VTOL X-plane called Lightning Strike. Liberty Works, which is our advanced technology wing in Indianapolis, is working on that. It's all about systems integrations, hybrid electric propulsion, and doing things very differently. And even if that doesn't, not sure what that aircraft future holds, but boy, it's a great opportunity to learn about so many different things, and we're very pleased to be working with Aurora on that one. We still have challenges. Cost, the money up there on the left mentions cost. We need to be able to do things faster, cheaper. If you've read any of the press, Rolls-Royce is in the middle of transforming our organization, making sure that we're as efficient as possible so we can give our people the best chance of doing things without the distractions of too much bureaucracy. How do we do things be very efficient so that we can then offer the best product to our customers at the lowest cost? Environment, as I mentioned, that we still have targets that we're striving to achieve, and it's not just in our products, it's also in just our business operations, just everyday operations, reducing our footprint, our carbon footprint on and our energy usage as we do office actions, as we make parts. So continuing to pay attention to environmental concerns just for that as well. And digital transformation, data security, all the data that's generated, what we're going to be doing with it. It's a digital awareness, cybersecurity. All that is just a area of growth, and looking for people who haven't traditionally been in our workforce, like computer science people, software engineers. That is an area where getting those skills in to help us sort out some of these digital transformation issues will be important. Looking at other industries like the autonomy that's already been mentioned, how do we look at what's going on in other industries like automotive and make sure that we're looking at that for what we want to do in aerospace as well, and how that might even change our business models. It's not just the products and the technologies that could change, but also how could transportation options help change our business models, understanding that and having people there that can help with that. At Rolls-Royce, we don't try and do it alone. We have a University Technology Center network where we have 31 UTCs around the world, Oxford, Cambridge. In the US, we have Purdue, Virginia Tech, and University of Virginia that help us look out there for things. They do research for us. They come to us with ideas that they see. We get them together once a year as a global gathering so they can talk to each other and look for trends, and we can share business plans with them and business needs and strategies, and then they can come in and help us. In the US, we're very pleased that we're partnered with those three universities much more than just doing research. We sit on advisory councils, they sit on our advisory councils, we recruit, and it's a great way to work with the universities, let them know what we're looking for, and they can tell us what they see as trends that we ought to know about as we're going forward. SBIRs, we have a strong small business innovative research program because we know we don't have all the ideas. There's lots of good ideas out there. There's diversity of thought, diversities of technology development. It's important that we look out there for what else might be available, and for that idea that somebody has that's so interesting that we need to think a little outside the box and figure out how we're going to take advantage of that. And finally, a little bit about future workforce and the culture. One of the things that's managed in my area is our graduate development program, which is a competitive program for college graduates to get onto. They have some special opportunities with a rotational program and a very intensive design make session. And it's really, really great to work with that younger workforce because I find them to be enthusiastic, challenging, challenge the norm. They are diverse in nature, diverse in thought, passionate. Our challenge is to keep that passion going because, they're more mobile. This is a more mobile generation. So keeping that passion going and so that we can take advantage of it and understand the work environment and what kind of work environment we need to be offering to this next generation. Fostering a network of teamwork, innovation, curiosity. That entrepreneur, that is not a typo. I meant it. That's a word I've learned recently from our younger generation. it's entrepreneurial spirit within a company. So our younger folks are very interested in that entrepreneurial spirit. We do things like up in the upper right-hand corner, you see our teaming our more experienced engineers with the younger ones. We have a Big Ideas Forum, which is kind of like a Shark Tank thing, where they come to us with ideas. And if they get some funding, that's great. They can progress that a little bit. Hackathon is not a bad thing. Hackathon is traditionally a global computer programming thing. We've turned that into doing some of that, but also just look for global opportunities and reaching out globally to how we can work on some of the company's issues. And of course, as all these guys up here, STEM outreach. You know, we have a very active STEM outreach program in colleges and high schools, middle schools, and that's so important to get the next generation interested in understanding that aerospace could be a something where they could put their career. And that's my 10 minutes. So I'll.
Thank you, Lisa. Mm-hmm.
Thanks to all the panel members. Let's see, in exchange for agreeing to be the moderator, moderators get a couple of privileges. One is to look at the questions that have been submitted and exercise a little bit of judgment, not much. We're gonna go with the social preferences. But I'm also, the other thing I get to do is make some observations based on everyone's comments. And I made some notes on what I thought were some particularly interesting comments by the panel. Robbie talked about immigration in the large, you know, your comments, stapling a green card to your degree, and there are some questions on that. I look at it, and I was thinking about your comment. I can't imagine this country without a healthy immigration policy. My own grandparents were born about, in round numbers, around 125 years ago. Those grandparents were born. Their parents, their eight parents, came from six different countries. I mean, what is this country without immigration? And if we can't, like many of you out there, when I went to graduate school, I was surrounded by people from other countries and other cultures. If we cannot find a way again to make it attractive for those people to stay here, and if we don't think about that and deliberately try to make it attractive for those people to stay here, our country will wither. So I think your comment, your observation, Robbie, needs more time than it got. Someone mentioned organizational conflicts of interest. Well, you know, those are self-imposed by our legal and regulatory framework. When we decide that the costs of preventing people from moving between government and industry and academia are more than the costs of the very occasional corruption that is observed, then we'll fix those policies. My own view would be that we need to be sounding the alarm, because there is far greater benefit that accrues to our nation from allowing people to move freely among the stovepipes and the sectors than there is harm done by the occasional bad actor. I believe it was Doug mentioned first millennials, and others have mentioned mission focus. I think we do younger people an enormous disservice if we don't recognize that they are and can be as much mission focused on grand challenges as any of us ever were in our own time. You know, why is NASA and the aerospace industry, why are they able to keep any IT people? Because if you work in IT, writ broadly, in the aerospace industry, you work on Mars Curiosity or the 787 or the Space Launch System, or Orion, or you're not working on Facebook. And that makes a difference for a lot of people, and I think as much so for our younger folks as for folks who, as I said earlier, are fighting the battle to see whether their hair is going to fall out or turn gray. There was a comment on this in the submitted questions, but Doug again mentioned other transactions authority. Well, the very fact of having to use other transactions authority is prima facie evidence that the acquisition system's not working. Why dream up ways to go around the acquisition system when the more straightforward approach is to fix it? So just, that's almost a rhetorical question. So leaving now with my couple minutes of observations on the, my observations on the observations of the panelists, let me go to questions. I can't ignore this one. We have 15 votes for it. So with the passing of the pension system in many large aerospace and technology companies, people need to learn to write, do we foresee greater acceptance of movement between competing companies? Is such diversification something to be encouraged? And what do you think will be the new strategy to retain talent? So I think that last, the last part of that question is a significant part. What is going to be the corporate strategy or government strategy or strategy in academia to retain talent? I'd like to hear your thoughts on that, and clearly the people who voted would like to hear your thoughts on that. What, Lisa, we ended with you. Why don't we start with you? How's Rolls-Royce going to retain talent?
Well, one of the things that we'd like to do is we'd like to start with them early. We have a strong cooperative education program. We have a strong internship program. So and we like to tie together the research that we do there with the recruitment activities and try and get people to know us. Getting to understand what we do on campus is important. And yeah, sometimes we go to campuses and we still hear the, you don't do cars? but we do something better, airplane engines, that's great. So we like to start early. We've actually, there's a program that we work with Indianapolis Public School System called Science Bound, now called Purdue Bound, and we work with that. We've had kids go through that that have then gone to Purdue and then they've come to work for us. We've had co-ops that have come through and worked for us. And so getting them early to understand how exciting this business is part of it. But in terms of that, how do we retain them? Yeah, retention is something that we talk about. It's something that we as employees leave, because they do. You know, they have other opportunities, and they have other opportunities in propulsion in the U.S. And some of them leave and go to airframe customers. Okay, and we do go back and forth some. So getting experience is we have a lot of movement, and that's okay. You know, there are people who bring something with the experience they get. But I think going forward, paying attention to the millennials and making sure that the work environment is such that they feel like they're contributing and they're excited, that is going to be a challenge, because it costs money to bring employees in. Yes, we realize there's churn in the industry, but between trying to foster those relationships early as possible, and working on the work environment itself and trying to cut out the bureaucracy and stuff like that just drives people crazy, those are the things that we're doing.
Okay, yeah, let's not have everybody answer every question, but those who would like to offer a comment. Doug?
Well, let me just add to this one, yeah. And then I'll be quiet for...
No, don't do that. Retention.
Yeah, I'll tell you, because I'm really passionate about this topic. When we do our exit interviews, when we find folks leave, one of the reasons we find that they leave is that they feel that they just are an island. And in fact, you know, I'm going here to Albuquerque and I'm going to spend some time with our younger workforce in an all-call. And one of the things I tell them, and I'm going to spend some time with the first-level supervisors, and I tell first-level supervisors, you have the most impactful job in our organization. And I think too often, you know, what's the migration of engineers? You know, based on your technical abilities, you get promoted to supervisor. And I think too often we promote the wrong folks into those supervisory positions. So the short answer is, one of the things that we're trying to do is make that supervisor to employee relation, because I think that's where we lose them, is they feel like they are not being mentored, they're an island in the organization, and they lose that purpose. And I tell you, it's a full contact sport being a supervisor.
Well, and people join the aerospace profession, if they don't join in part because they want to be part of something bigger than themselves, then they're in the wrong spot.
Right.
And when, as you point out, if we leave them to be an island among themselves, we don't satisfy the first motivation they ever had. Yeah. Ken, you're leaning forward.
Yeah, a couple things. One is, per my comments, we are getting into an area where there's just less dependence between the employee and the company. You mentioned the pension situation, not unique to our industry. So we are migrating more toward 401k, and doesn't mean we walk away. We help people, we match, but less dependence on a pension system because our industry, just like others, it's the numbers have gotten to a point that are not sustainable. I agree with you, Mike. The aspect of there's so much, it's not an either or, there's so much with our industry that attracts young people. And so whether it's working on a commercial platform or even some technology, right? It's for us to give the freedom of people and create an opportunity that causes them the excitement to want to stay. I'll mention just one quick example. Through all my travels, I was at our Moscow Design Center, and I was touring, and I was talking with the different people in the design center. I met a young woman there. She had worked for, the company Boeing for I don't know how many years, but probably not 10. And I asked her, I had my own bias, if you will. I asked her, have you ever been to the United States or thought about coming to the United States? And she said, yes, I've been to Everett, where I'm based, I've 7 times. So where would someone, in another part of the world have these kinds of opportunities? I can tell you that in my career, I think the first trip I was international, I gave a paper in the UK, and there were probably, back to the bureaucracies, 20 sign-offs. And here's a young woman with probably 5-6 years experience, and she regularly came back to coordinate with the program.
I think we can probably all agree that reduction of non-value added activity is a huge retention tool. Robbie, one more quick comment, and then I'm going to move on to another question. We just got too many questions.
Sure, absolutely. So just a few more things on the retention side, because obviously there's recruitment, then on retention. I think at the end of the day, there's an interesting tension within our sector, or actually broader in the high-tech sector. If you look at basically surveys of graduates, there is a propensity to be attracted to startups and smaller companies.
Sure.
But in startups and smaller companies, you don't have the diversity of experiences. Mm-hmm. So now you look at larger companies, and so for instance, in a Lockheed Martin with 4 business unit areas, right? If you don't want to do space after 5 years, we can put you on submarines, for the next 5 years. So it's I think the key to retention is really to have these individuals go across to all of the disciplines and the various domains within aerospace. And that gets back to actually what the
as long as Air Force. As long as that kind of mobility is encouraged and not discouraged,
that's
it
right.
Can be
it's
easier to change companies than to change jobs within a company.
That's right.
So hire, senior corporate managers, I think, need to notice
that.
That's right. Let me move on. The combination of the questions about the observation I made about being able to find our best stuff in museums and the question about the Apollo program dominates everything else. So I'll just read the question. The Apollo program was a huge inspiration for generations of engineers. What is the inspiration for future engineers? This again gets back to mission focus. So this question is dominating everything else when you add them up. So Kevin, why don't I start with you, since you didn't get to comment on the last one. So what's our...
I'd love to actually comment on the last one, because we're doing a tremendous amount with that, but maybe I'll save that for later if there's time.
So what's the inspiration for future engineers?
That's actually a tough one. It really is. I think it's hard to... I think Mars is brought up as an example. The extent to which people can work on the Mars program or the Mars initiative is pretty limited to a few organizations right now. So I think that has the potential.
Well, mostly because it's not a real initiative, so.
Right. So
there's more questions coming now.
Go on.
So it has the potential of being that. Beyond that, I think you just get back to, and I think we've all touched on this, the fundamental mission. You know, we have a mission statement of preserving freedom and advancing human discovery. And I think when you contrast that to many jobs out there, how many jobs can say that? How many people can say they work for a company that do either of those things, much less both?
So, well, in my opinion, we don't have enough engineers who can distill things down and correctly say that we work on, you know, human discovery and preserving freedom and security. And that's a good way to put it. We need to do that. We need to do more of that. So other comments. What about inspiration for the future, Robbie?
So, you know, we have to put Apollo in its proper historical context, right? It was a geostrategic political struggle. It was an existential struggle.
As is almost all of the aerospace sector, right? It's almost all about national security,
right.
Really,
right.
In the end.
So at the end, it was a compelling national security reason. In today's dollars, Apollo was $125 billion. The infrastructure that was developed across the country, it was amazing. But what happens in human endeavors is when you do this, you know, it's almost like when you're a student, you pull an all-nighter for that final exam. What's your retention of the knowledge? So we did this amazing, 1969, land a man on the moon, bring them back safely. And then by the second or third flight, half of the US wasn't even watching the flights on television, right? So there has to be something that is sustainable and enduring. I think one of the things that really attracts engineers today, and it's a bit amorphous, but it is about having an impact, making their world better. And whether it's on the human dimension, whether it's on the environmental dimension, and it's on a time scale that you can see the fruits of your work in a very short amount of years, and not wait for a decade and a half before you go from requirements to finally maybe seeing something fly. And that acceleration of a time scale is something in which gets back to some of the things that Doug mentioned, like in the DoD, where the pristine requirements are driving things, but it takes you a decade and two decades to accomplish now what is going to be good enough. Right?
I think that's a very salient point. Many years ago, Freeman Dyson, one of the great physicists of the century, published a book of essays called Disturbing the Universe. It's probably 45 years ago. And one of the essays he commented on was basically the requirement of human beings to work on something which has clear milestones and deliverables at reasonable intervals. Mm-hmm. And that they can be and should be linked strategically to larger goals, but that there have to be intermediate goals because that's the way humans are built. And so without apologizing for the way humans are built, we need to respect that in our program planning, which is one of the things Kevin mentioned Mars. That's one of the things that makes Mars difficult, because if you don't set the program up to have intermediate goals, it's going to fail the Dyson test. I suspect there have been very few policy planners as smart as Freeman Dyson, and maybe we should listen to him. So, other comments? What will inspire people, Ken?
Well, I think we don't have to go to the chart, but if you remember the first chart I showed, I mean, that's enough. It's really just plugging in the people into all the needs. We really have so many different things that we're trying to solve, and so, you know, it goes back to the rigidity of the company, the flexibility. Same thing true, Doug, on the government side is creating the process by which people can move, right? We have, like all of you, you know, the co-op program, summer intern program, and so forth. And as part of that, we get the young people out into the factory all over. You know, if you can imagine the Puget Sound, all the fun places,
Engineers become engineers because they want to make things.
Absolutely. So, I mean, just in Everett alone, you know, you can walk the largest factory in the world, see 8-7s, 4-7s, 777s, tankers. So it's there. It's just us connecting and finding out what the interests are and then plugging the people in.
That's a good comment about how to inspire folks.
I really think it's true. And again, you know, I referenced the young woman is that just the opportunity to work on things this big and have that kind of responsibility. The other thing I like to do is create the opportunity for these people to brief at the program level, and safe environment. They get the experience and just, you know, it's just so neat to see them and get their ideas, and it's rewarding, I think, on their side to, you know, feel to be a valued part of something big.
Yes, when a young person can brief senior management, that's a pretty heady experience. One more comment, Kevin.
Yeah, so I just want to pull on that thread a little bit. I think the extent to which we as companies give our employees opportunities to explore and problem solve even beyond the day job, I think is really powerful. We've set up corporate makerspaces we call our Fab Labs. Mm-hmm. And we provide materials and a space that has, you know, things you can build, and you can use it for personal or work use. And so it causes people to think, well, what do I want to do with this? And it's led to some pretty tremendous things. We have a partnership with an organization called Helping Hands. And periodically our people get together and build 3D print prosthetic hands for kids who've lost their limbs. And they love it. And we've helped the local artist kind of regain his art who has muscular dystrophy. We've partnered with the San Diego Zoo Global in a competition around a wildlife preservation. And they're building quadcopters. And this is all in their free time to contribute in this way. And I think this gets back to the magnet for talent as well, or attracting and retaining talent, is providing those outlets for employees to be able to use their problem-solving skills in many different ways.
Yep.
Diversity.
Well, let me move on to another question that I think might spark a good discussion. What future trends under discussion today do you feel are the most overhyped or overrated? So what you know, I guess distinguishing between form and substance here. So Doug, you want to take a crack at one?
Well, that's a dangerous question.
Yeah, but you and I are used to having arrows from the front, right?
Yeah,
so it's okay.
So I don't know if you've noticed, I think something that was overhyped was, we talked a lot about offset strategies. You know, the first offset, second offset, third offset. And I think you're starting to see the department downplay a little bit of that third offset because, you know, I think, you know, they truly were offsets. But when you talk about hype, there's a lot hyped around that. You know, maybe within the Air Force also, you know, we talk a lot about game changers, you know, the three game changers of hypersonics, directed energy, and autonomy. I don't think those are overhyped, though. I mean, I think we've talked a lot about, you know, autonomy. I will tell you, as a government employee that flying from L.A. to Australia, I sit in the back and coach for 14, 15 hours. I'm hoping hypersonics, so help us get there, all right? Because I just want to get there quicker. It's all in the messaging, though. And there is a risk of maybe hyping it a little bit too much. So those are maybe a couple of examples.
Okay, Lisa?
Ooh.
What's overhyped?
That's dangerous to ask a propulsion guy because we just support these guys. overhyped.
You can pass.
I think I'll pass on this one.
Okay. Anyone else on the panel? What's been overhyped or overemphasized or you know, too flashy for the substance? Robbie?
Okay, I'll go out on dangerous territory, but as the chair of the conference, let's get a conversation started. What I think, and I don't want to say overhype, what I like to say is put things in context and basically look at something from a relative perspective. I think there has been over the last, in recent times, going along with this third offset, there has been this overemphasis on what is coming from Silicon Valley writ large. And I'm going to nuance my comments. There's invention and there's innovation. And what I think has been lost in a lot of the discussion, yes, there's speed, yes, there's passion, yes, there's a lot of money. But there has been a downplaying of the role that government labs play in the invention process. And a lot of the expertise, especially that is so mission-focused, that cannot be ignored. And I think a lot of the senior leadership, actually, in government agencies have said, we're trying to go out, and it's right, we need to keep the aperture open, diversity of views and opinions, but let's not forget that we have internally some jewels, and let's make sure that they are resourced and appropriately retained for unique things that these other ecosystems will never be financially incentivized to pursue. And I think that was one of the messages that came out yesterday was that, you know, we talk about risk adversity, et cetera. Some purely commercial entities sometimes do not take as much risk as government does when it pushes the boundaries of performance.
As somebody who has run a couple of commercial enterprises, I'll make the point that there's really only so much risk you can take on if you hope to be in business next year. So there's
nuance. I just wanted there's nuance in the discussion, and it was like in the lot of the discussions when you were there and with what happens with commercial space or really with the private sector.
I was
space.
About to pick up on that. One of the things that I think has been overhyped both in DoD and in civil side is, broadly speaking, I'll say COTS, commercial off the shelf, and the idea that we can pick those things up and use them to satisfy governmental needs or societal needs. I'm a little frustrated by that because no one wants commercial activity in the aerospace sector, I think, more than I do. But we also need to look at the numbers. We have a commercial communication satellite industry that's, a couple $100 billion. Okay, that's a real number. It's extraordinarily valuable, but it would not be able to exist. The sector would not exist if it could not tag along onto all of the basically government purpose-built infrastructure that allows it to say, oh, by the way, let me borrow that and I'll develop communications. You know, we have a $25 billion and increasing position servicing industry. It wouldn't be able to exist without a massive multi-government investment in satellite navigation technology for national security purposes for the various nations which have developed it. And so in our sector, I think we are in danger of overhyping the ability of COTS solutions to satisfy needs which were fundamentally developed for geopolitical or national security purposes. And my own take is I don't want them to be overhyped because I want it to succeed. Yeah. And I think by promising what is undeliverable, we risk an adverse reaction in the other direction.
That's right.
And one questioner asked essentially the same thing you're talking about, except he called it Silicon Valley. But I think the Silicon Valley emphasis is an example of that. Kevin?
So the brain drain that we're faced with is not overhyped. I mean, we are faced with a tremendous number of people in our industry that have a tremendous amount of knowledge that are at retirement age or about to be. What I do think is overhyped is how hard it is to retain that, or how hard it is to get that knowledge out of them. I have yet to ever have anybody that I asked, just tell me what you do and how you do it, that they weren't happy to share. I think the problem is we're not asking, and there are very simple solutions, and I think we're overcomplicating
it. And you can't put it in a book.
You can't write it down.
I've written two books, and I'll tell you, most of what I know about space vehicle design, I can't write down.
Right.
And,
right.
And anybody who writes something down knows that the real art is between the lines.
And this era of YouTube, you know, I've discovered YouTube to fix my car, and you know, many for my very specific vehicle type, how do I do this? And it's right there. Somebody's teaching me. So this this teaching mechanism, if you literally just record some sessions where people are interacting and asking questions and learning, now suddenly it's available for the masses if you upload it. They're very simple things, and we're just not utilizing them like we should, and we're not asking the right questions.
Okay, well, let's move on to another question, a great one that was asked, I think, with possibly some interesting answers. Is when DOD can use additive manufacturing to print full weapon systems, will there be a large decrease in the need for prime contracts or contractors? I'm not quite sure what the intent was, but I think the overall thrust is clear. That's a fascinating topic. I guess my own take would be no, it's not going to change the need for prime contracts or maybe even the number, but their nature may change. Their nature may change, but I'd like to hear the panel's reactions. I mean, you know, Lisa, when we can print a jet engine, what happens at Rolls-Royce?
Well, one thing, we're learning to print. You know, we're doing the 3D printing and looking at different additive manufacturing methods to improve our manufacturing. And with additive manufacturing, one of the things that's really key to that is the fact that you can tie that to the design process. And the design process you can't always show on a print. You know, the fact that with modern manufacturing you can tie design systems, material systems, and manufacturing all together, that stuff doesn't always exist on a print. So that's the value that we think we'll continue to add in the making sure that part is the best part for purpose, regardless of how you make it. And if it's possible to make out of 3D printing at some point in time, then we'll deal with our customers at that point. But we think that we can bring value in understanding the value that manufacturing process can bring to the design.
Well, Mike, I'd just like to point out that I think it was the F-22 that was the first aircraft where the actual cost of the aircraft, the majority, was in software and avionics, vice the actual hardware, the engines, the airframe, the landing gear, etc. So 3D printing can address the hardware aspects, but the systems integration of complex avionics, the sensing, weapon systems, you're not 3D printing that, right? And my comment about software still having advanced, there's a divergence between hardware performance and software development. That's something 3D printing obviously won't fix.
Right. The sufficiently flexible actuators can do an awful lot of different things depending on what software drives them.
Right.
So humans are a nice example of that. Ken, you have a comment?
Yeah. It's an interesting question because the assumption is that the companies aren't able to adapt to the new technology and that someone else would just do that. I would say give us a little bit more credit than that. As of last week, I think Boeing had made the largest item out of additive manufacturing. It turns out to be a 777X tool. Now that was last week. Given the pace that this thing is going, it's probably been surpassed by something larger. So I think the question will be is, and it's true for any company, large or small, is your ability to see what's out there and then move quickly. And all of this is about time to market, meeting requirements, time to market, and doing it such that we keep the shareholders happy. And that's true whether it's a 5-person company or a 150,000-person company.
Yep, I think that's a good discussion. It's additive manufacturing may change the nature of what it is that primes do, but I don't think it's going to change
You know, again, we're not in the business of production,
right.
The government.
Right.
The one aspect of additive that we see great benefit is on-demand supplies. You know, if I've got a part and it's in Afghanistan and I got to get it there,
You know, oftentimes getting parts through customs takes longer than anything, and if I have the ability then to just load up the machine, hit the print button, and then 4 hours later I come back and it's printed on site there, I think from a supply chain management, that may revolutionize, but and that may put more of that work effort on the organic government side, but we will still rely on our industry partners.
Right. I mean, manufacturing has been defined as the process of taking inexpensive things and recombining them to make them more expensive. And commerce has been defined as the process of moving things from where they're cheap to where they cost more.
Yeah, if I can just add on what Doug said, yes, the whole aspect of what happens in service and service support, as an engine company working on that aspect of supporting our customers, yeah, additive manufacturing could very well play into the future strategy of how we best support the customers in the field.
But that's support, need for support is not going to change. All right, I think that was an intriguing question, and I think we answered it.
Yes.
With apologies, I have to answer the most popular, for some reason, question on the list, which is there any chance that I will return as NASA administrator? You guys are just really bad. I have no idea what the new administration is going to do, and as any of us who've ever served in government, we serve at the pleasure of the administration. I have no idea. I really don't. So now let's move on to a more useful question.
Exactly. That was not a no.
It was an I don't know. It was an I don't know. We don't make these things happen ourselves. They happen to us. A very popular question is how much 6.1 research, meaning basic research, basic R&D, are you doing in-house, and why not more, considering this drives all new advancements? Now, you know, if that can be addressed to government, it can be addressed to industry, although less so. Again, a great way to go broke in industry is trying to do too much 6.1. But I think it's a question that faces us as a society. Possibly the first person with a significant government role ever to address this question was the president's science advisor, Dr. Vannevar Bush, who served Franklin Roosevelt and Harry Truman during and in the immediate aftermath of World War II. And Dr. Bush, no relation to the president's Bush, wrote a seminal document called Science, the New Frontier, which shaped three generations of thinking about the role of government on behalf of society in fostering new developments which were individually risky but societal, which had large payoff for society broadly speaking. I've observed in other fora that we seem to have drifted away from the strategic theme embodied in that document, and that is essentially the point of this question, is, you know, why are we not doing more of that? So whether you serve today in government or industry, I'd like to hear from some of the panel on that. Kevin?
Well, we've just actually doubled down on 6.1. We've doubled down on basic research. We've
created an area called NG Next that has a basic research, applied research, and rapid prototyping arms. And in the basic research area, we've made it a proprietary free zone. We want collaborators to come in. We want professors to do sabbaticals in our spaces, shoulder to shoulder with us, and to publish. And so we really believe that is critical for industry to get more involved in. And I think we've moved, the pendulum tends to swing, right?
Yeah, it does.
And I think it swung too far over on the almost nothing. And of the basic research, just on applied, and so we're trying to create some balance in the force, so to speak. And it's been really inspiring for our people as well. So we have certain areas we're doing that research in that we think probably have relevance in the future to our business. But for now, we're just exploring it.
That's an encouraging answer. Robbie?
So when we say basic research, first of all, we have to be a little strict on definitions, because when we say 6-1, that's a DOD term.
It is.
There is curiosity-driven research, basic research, National Science Foundation, for instance. But there is also a term that, that Mike, when you were at NASA in the aeronautics front, you know, Lisa Port and I, it was called foundational research,
right,
which is basic research, but with an end applied state in mind. So from an industry perspective, we have actually a laboratory enterprise across Lockheed Martin. We have our, you know, each business area has a laboratory, their Advanced Technology Center in space. We have a corporate-wide lab, Advanced Technology Laboratory. And we obviously have a component of our Skunk Works within Aero. There is a component of basic research, but we are not doing curiosity-driven basic research, right? There's an end state. That's the role that our university partners. So at the end of the day, we work with our government customers and our university partners to say, what are those breakthroughs we really need to have that the basic research community can contribute to? And then the biggest issue is, one can do all kinds of beautiful basic research, but it's the transition issue. So we've got to focus on that applied research and advanced technology development. It's really that 6-3 into the 6-4 realm that will take that knowledge and actually turn it into something that's going to be useful for our customers.
Yeah, the valley of death is always there.
Exactly, that's right.
The only comment I would add to that is, you know, part of the AFRL mission, we do have, by definition, 6-1 funding. You
right.
know, to one significant digit, it's about $400 million a year. To the question about how much is intramural versus extramural, about 25% of that is intramural to white coats in government labs. So the predominance of it is university grants, by and large. The one thing that we've changed over, I would offer maybe over the last 5 years or so, is there's greater focus to ensure that we're servicing not only, you know, our academic partners here in the States, but through offices in London, Santiago, Chile, and Tokyo, we see a worldwide presence that you really need to go to the ends of the earth to fully leverage that basic research dollar. Because you're really investing in most cases, a face.
Right.
An individual.
Right, absolutely. Well, let me move on. There's another really top-rated question, which, and I think should be, how do you sell the value of activities without immediate value, I'm going to say immediate payoff, like conferences, when we need to get rid of work that doesn't add to the mission? Because several of us pointed out if there's anything that's been overhyped, it's been bureaucratic process in our industry, and we all know that we need to have less of that. And yet, if you're going to get rid of non-value-added activities, how do you retain those that don't have an immediately apparent payoff? And the questioner asked, like conferences. I think that's a critical question. And I think my own answer to that would be that one needs an intelligently applied definition of value to the mission. Not every bit of value pays off today. Engineering is a team sport, and the myth of the individual contributor may not be completely a myth, but it's largely a myth. We collaborate. Engineers who cannot learn early in their careers to collaborate don't stay long in the engineering profession because their peers won't work with them. And conferences and professional society exchanges are possibly the premier way in which we allow ourselves to collaborate. And we all need to recognize that, and moreover, we need to be saying it to the people who are crafting the rules on what government can do and industry can do with its money. That's my answer, but I'd like to hear from the panelists. Lisa?
Yeah, that's a question we hear, because even if you go to a conference, there is some objective for people coming here. You're gonna meet people, you're gonna network people, find out what's going on, or make yourself known as an expert in something, which can be good, because we like for our customers to know that we know what we're talking about. And one of the ways we do that is coming to conferences and let them hear what we talk about. But even looking at another aspect of like STEM support, you know, we all do STEM support. that is a long-term investment. We'll go out to middle schools and high schools, and those students probably are not going to come and work for us. Why do we do it? Because we need to. There are certain things that we need to do that are longer-term investments that are just good for the industry and good for the companies, even though if there isn't an immediate payoff. But understanding that and having that adult conversation about the fact that it may not be an immediate turnaround or an immediate return on that investment, but is a longer term investment. Yeah, we have those discussions every budget cycle. and I'm glad to say that conferences is one thing that we like to send people to do. If you're a fellow, if you're a Rolls-Royce fellow, you're expected to have an outward face because you're an expert, and we want those experts to be seen as external. But it doesn't mean to say that we don't have budget discussions, just like I'm sure everybody else.
Okay, Kevin?
So there's a lot of research right now into how social interactions drive bottom line performance at a company.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, I think there was some MIT folks from the Center of Bits and Atoms, I know, were attendees at the conference, but one of the professors in the media lab, Dr. Alex Pentland, just recently wrote a book called Social Physics, where he's a big data scientist that's been able to measure the quantifiable benefit of some social interactions. And so while that translation to a conference setting back to companies and back to dollars is difficult, and we probably wouldn't take the time to do that, there is tangible evidence now by MIT and Dr. Pentland that there is tremendous value in that. It's a big lever, and some very specific examples of where that's the case. But I agree with what you both said, which is, you know, we just need to do it. It's important. There are aspects that it's measurable now, and we know that now. It's just fundamental to how we do business.
Yeah, we know it's important. Quantifying it is helpful. Robbie?
I think it's also important, getting back to one of the central themes of retaining good individuals in our workforce. You know, when you look across the motivations, yes, there are financial motivations, but at the end of the day, the technical workforce, at least I've seen in some surveys and other things, it's recognition by their peers. And right, and so the important role that organizations like the AIAA play in terms of recognizing across the community the contributions an individual has made, an associate fellow, a fellow, et cetera, and also doing this on the industry side, I think is very important. And then having the networks of these individuals and then bringing in the new talent and having this rich ecosystem work together is very, very important. And I think, you know, unfortunately on the government side, and there was an unfortunate incident a few years ago that really put a big damper on government involvement in conferences. And I've had some other laboratory directors say that this is probably one of the worst adverse impacts on the DoD S&T enterprise was the impact of not being able to fully participate in these important technical conferences.
Well, and very specifically, to recall for some of the audience who may not remember, the two incidents were, I believe there was a GSA conference in Las Vegas where people were found to be possibly entertaining inappropriately, and then we had Secret Servicemen engaging the services of less than reputable women in Colombia. And these two things, these two incidents right in a row, put a blight on government support for travel and conferences so far beyond the realm of the particular incidents involved that it's even difficult to draw the connection. But we're still seeing the effects of those today. I mean, we are Doug, and comment?
Yeah, I mean, that coupled with sequestration, and I mean, it was literally, if you wanted to go to a conference, the Secretary of the Air Force had to sign off on it. I mean, it went up to SAF AA for final adjudication.
Well, that would keep her busy for a while.
Yeah, so, but we're back to normal. Guess what? A supervisor can say you can go to the AIAA conference.
Okay. So here's an intriguing question. In 4 years, I don't know who picked 4 years or why, but the original questioner did, where do you see the greatest opportunities for those entering the workforce? So this is kind of short term. We've been talking about decades out, but in 4 years, where do you see the greatest opportunities? Anybody want to take a whack at that one? Well, I'm going to say I'm thinking hypersonics is pretty big because I think there's a, my opinion, I think there is a growing and significant appreciation of, frankly, the Russian and Chinese hypersonic threat, and that is a threat to our traditional way of projecting American power, which is carrier-based aviation.
So is the question technical, or is it kind of a role, like an engineer?
The question was the question.
Okay.
Where do you see the greatest opportunities? Maybe it's in tax accounting. I don't know.
So my I'll put it a thing on technology. I agree with you, hypersonics, but I'll say something more. It's going to be the confluence of electronic warfare or broader electromagnetic spectrum operations and cyber. Because at the end of the day, I think where we are, there's a lot of interesting, intellectually rewarding activity now is how do you develop these capabilities that at the end you'll never totally eliminate, but you can greatly reduce kinetic warfare.
Well,
you can blind, you can make it deaf and dumb, an adversary, and it's going to be basically through dominance of the electromagnetic spectrum.
Well, right, and in fact, to me, the most interesting question arising out of, you know, Hackergate over the last few weeks has been why were our hackers not there first? I mean, if whoever is engaging in these activities, if we're not first among equals, that's a potential threat. And that is the really significant question from a national security perspective is our people ought to be on top of that. Not, we shouldn't be reading about the news, we should be making it. Because that is a theater of war in the future.
You know, my response to that would be, and I tell you, if I had a seventh grader or a fifth grader right now that was mathematically, you know, science inclined, I would be pushing them towards mathematics. And I see data analytics as a domain that's scalable to so many applications that there's just, you know, whether it's autonomy, whether it's machine learning, whether it's combat ID, whether it's the synthesis of cyber, all of that is going to be on a backbone of mathematics. That's where I'd be pushing kids.
Well, that's a good comment. Yeah. Ken?
I really appreciate the question at this point, Mike, because if you reflect back on the previous questions we've had over the last 45 minutes or so, they've been more of the traditional questions that the traditional panels get. So my own comment before answering a question is, we're the industry. We have to dream bigger, think bigger, play bigger, or others will come into our domain. Anyway, to answer your question, I think it will be an extension of the things that we're doing. So space, I think there'll be greater movement there. I think greater introspection and solving the Earth's problems. Moving matter, so you know, we talked about the Jetsons. You know, we'll make a reference to Star Trek. We had the senior leadership meeting for Boeing here last week, and we had a panel and in terms of looking at the future, and someone posed the idea of using seeds, right, to germinate, to become products, aircraft. And, you know, traveling on an airplane back with some of my production friends, that was a little bit fun for them because they weren't able to see that. But the limiting factor in all of this is how far we dream. That's the limiter.
Yep.
So I'd encourage us to dream and play big because we're the limiting factor.
One thing we haven't touched on is design thinking and systems thinking. Well, I think we've touched on it kind of overarchingly, but the reason that the folks up here can answer that question is because we're looking at the big picture and we have a context. No matter what our discipline is, what we've studied, what we know deep, it's the whole T principle, right? We have a perspective at the high level, and the more of our people that have that ability to look across and say, what's really needed? How do I think holistically about the problems and about the missions? It benefits everyone, if all of us have that perspective, no matter how deep we're going in one research problem or one thing we're designing or piece part, So I think in some ways, many primes have lost lock on the systems thinking, design thinking, holistic thinking.
15 years ago, Tom Young in a Defense Science Board report made the point with his group of people, he chaired the report, made the point that the skill that we have atrophied is system engineering. Mm-hmm. So I'll just leave that at that, because I want to close with one more question, which I and neat question. What are some ways to reduce bureaucracy and root out processes that don't advance the mission without compromising safety? So I'm going to take the first swipe at that answer. Someone earlier on this panel mentioned crowdsourcing as a useful tool, and I think more and more we are seeing that. You know, I wonder what would be the result if in any given institution we crowdsourced the question, what are the processes that you think are the most valuable and what are the ones that you think add the least value? That would be a very interesting exercise to do in a government, academia, industry, you name it, the organization. You'd probably be surprised by what people valued and what they regarded as just not adding to the mission. Kevin?
So we have an initiative we call Bureaucracy Busting, and it's a crowdsourced initiative at Northrop Grumman. So leading the witness here.
I can't have an original thought anywhere at all. I just can't. I've passed my utility point.
So we're finishing our second year of that initiative, and basically we give permission to every employee to identify bureaucracy that they believe needs to be rooted out, and then the process owner needs to look and say what's required, mandated by our various rules and policies, versus what is just overlay based on typically knee-jerk reaction to some problem, right? And that just the band-aids on the band-aids on the band-aids, and you just gotta rip it all off at some point in time. So we measure our success in number of hours saved to employees. So you estimate, you know, what's the cause of this 20 signatures. What if we got to 3, how many hours would we save for X number of people? And we have millions of hours goals across our organization each year to root out bureaucracy. And it's been really powerful. And there's oftentimes things we don't even know or see that the people are like, oh my goodness, this is huge. And our executive leadership team once a month reviews bureaucracy that's being rooted out.
Makes Boy, that's neat. Lisa?
Number one to me is involve the employee. You know, whether it's surveys for where they feel their time is wasted, or whether it's more official at workshops, whether it's green belt, master, black belt, led official projects, or we actually have a requirement that everybody do something. Look at something that you're doing and do it better. It can be little, but the little things can add up. So like I said, number one, involve the employees, because it just doesn't work if you do a top-down, you're inefficient, so here, we're going to fix it for you. Involve the employees, make sure you understand what their frustrations are, and then use a mix of, well, just go fix it, and the more official workshops when you need to involve lots of different people.
All right, I think with that, we're done for this panel. I want to thank the panel members. I appreciate your thoughtful comments and responses. I want to thank Pam Bertelsen for pulling it all together and the audience for such great questions. It's great for moderators now because I've been doing this for roughly 1,000 years and now we don't have to think up our own questions anymore. It's great. Thank you, all of you, very much.